हेलो। हाय रोहित,
हेलो।
आई थिंक वी कैन गिव इट अ स्टार्ट। इफ एनीवन एल्स इज जॉइन, दे कैन जॉइन इन। सो लेट्स गिव इट अ स्टार्ट। आई थिंक यू कैन सी माय स्क्रीन।
यस
या ओके ओके। सो लेट्स गो अहेड, लेट्स लुक इनटू सम अदर फंक्शंस नाउ। So until the last day, we have looked until some of the very basic date functions. So example will be something like this, the one that we saw on the last day, right? So we selected the current date and time, which is now. We extracted the year, month, and day. It has obviously changed now because it is extracting the data from the current time. So obviously it is changing it. If you remember, also we discussed that this time is actually shown over here basis not the the server time, but this is overridden by the time of the MySQL database instance itself. So that's why the time might not be matching with the actual clock time. In my clock, it is 8:42, and you can see over here that it is 15:11. It's like afternoon time. This may well be because of, let's say, this time zone might be into, let's say, UTC format and so on. So these are the common date functions which we saw. Just to recap, now was current day. These are functions on top of the current date and time that we can do. Now, just to quickly reiterate, I'm not sure if I was clear enough or maybe I missed to communicate this. So if I have any date field, right, if I have any column in the database which is actually a date field, I will be able to apply these functions on those date fields as well. So it is not that year function will always take the input as the as another function, which is the current date and so on. So instead of now, let's say I can pass something else as well. So let's say I have some column, I have some table where I have some column which is a date time column D1, and I have some other column C1 and let's say C2. Right, I would like to select D1 and C2, and then I would also like to print, let's say, the year or the month out of D1. Yeah, then I can use the year function. I can use the year function and pass the value as D1. It should be able to extract the year value out of this date, provided the value which I have stored in these rows, right, in the D1 column is following the standard, let's say, nomenclature. Okay, so whenever I'm inserting data which we have not seen yet, we have not seen DML operations by means of which we can insert data. So whenever we are loading data into this table, let's say this table is T1, and whenever we are loading data into columns like D1, C1, and C2, we have to ensure that we are entering it some agreed date time format. It may or may not be exactly this format which is ongoing, but it may well be some other format. It should be recognizable or, let's say, understandable by the MySQL database engine. If that's the case, then clearly we will be able to use year function, or let's say month name function, or a day name function, or hour function, or minute function, or second function, right? All of these functions that we have seen above, the one that you see in the queries as well, we should be able to use all of them into this date field, and we should be able to extract that information, right? Now, this is the first point I wanted to tell you. The other point which I wanted to tell you is that these kind of functions, right? Now, why are we, from a data science kind of a perspective, why are we learning these functions? Because these kind of functions really help extract features. Okay, this is a concept of feature extraction which we have really not looked into, honestly. Because we have not done any use case yet where we have to extract features. But I can quickly give you an example. Of course, at later stage, we will be looking at it. Let's say I was doing once a project on some data that I got related to Uber cars, okay, related to the Uber cabs which are running on Mumbai, in the Mumbai city. I got some data related to this. It is a completely open source kind of a data, and it is completely masked. So it is released by the Uber company, and I was able to get hold of that. I will also be sharing at later date. We will do a case study on this as well. So at that time, we can see the data. So there, my primary objective was to analyze the data and find patterns to answer a very, very important question. Obviously, as I have said earlier, there must be some question which we are trying to answer, right, by means of, let's say, doing the data science. So the question that I was trying to answer is, why is it always the case that we see a lot of cancellations at specific point in time when people are booking cabs from the airport? Okay, I'm not sure whether you have personally faced this or not, but this kind of a very common complaint that you see on any review boards, on any review forums, that people who are coming to Mumbai, let's say I'm traveling to Mumbai at a certain point in time, and I've landed on the domestic airport. Usually this is not the case with international airport, but in the domestic airport into Mumbai, at certain day of the week or at certain time of that day of the week, I book a cab. I'm waiting for that cab. I can see in my app that the cab is actually coming. It is coming. I can see that in the GPS. All of a sudden, the cab driver cancels. And that cab driver gives some unwanted or unknown kind of a reason that I'm not able to contact the customer and all those things. Although he or she has not really contacted you. The driver never called you. The driver was coming towards you. And all of a sudden, I don't know what happened. He or she canceled it. Or maybe even a better kind of a situation where you are standing at your location. The cab is also standing at their location. The cab driver is not moving towards you, right? You can clearly track the movement from the app, right? So from there, you see they are not moving towards you. All of a sudden, maybe 15 minutes after waiting for 15 minutes, it is really very problematic to see such kind of problem that after waiting for 15 minutes, you see the cab driver has canceled the subscription. Now you have to again book a cab and then wait. So it is kind of not a problem for you to book another cab. So that is not an issue. I have an app. I have the internet connection. I can book as many cabs as I want. But the wastage of 15 minutes is a problem. So the use case is as simple as do exploratory data analysis. This is an EDA use case actually. We will be doing this, of course. So do exploratory data analysis to clearly find out, is there any pattern? Okay, is there any specific time of day or time of week or any specific kind of a flow or a pattern or a kind of a property that you can find within the cab drivers which are available near the domestic airport, into Mumbai, who are intentionally or unintentionally, we don't know why they are cancelling it, we don't know that. We can only assume what can be the reason, but can we assume that basis the data is the question. So when I was working on that project, right, there was a date field there. The date time field was specifically the date and time when the customer is actually booking the cab, or let's say how many minutes he has waited before the cancellation or before the cab arrived and so on and so forth. So I was able to extract, if at that point in time, you can try to imagine if I'm able to extract the week name, right, the week name, the day name, the month name kind of thing, I can get some very useful patterns if this kind of a scenario is happening with the customers on a particular day of the week or particular month or particular time in the day and so on. If there is anything that we can visually represent that, okay, the cancellation rates are higher in the middle of the week, but maybe also the fact that the cancellation rates are higher at the end of the week and so on. So to gather such kind of insights, right, we are simply extracting fields. We are extracting fields out of an existing field. Right, this is known as feature extraction, and during machine learning, we will be doing a lot of such things, irrespective of whether we are trying to predict something or whether we are trying to really try to find out, let's say, the format or let's say the patterns. Right, so this is really useful. So these functions are actually helpful in that case. Okay, so let's just keep that in mind and let's continue with some more functions, and we'll continue with more of some date functions. So one such date function that is very, sometimes it is useful, sometimes it is not useful, is something like I can use a date function. I can use a date function to add a date. So example given, I'm going to select, let's say now. Okay, if I select now, it is going to give me the current date and time, right? I just want to know what is going to be the time or what is going to be the date and time after a certain point in time. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I'm going to use a function called date underscore add, right? Obviously, when I'm calling this, it is giving an error because it requires at least two arguments. So the first argument is what is the input, what is the date. In this case, I'm taking sysdate just to simplify things. And the second argument is going to be what is the interval. Okay, what is the delta by means of which you would like to increase the date. Okay, this is date add, so we are trying to increase the date. So let's say I'm going to say I just want to increase the date. Increase the date by, 3 days. Right. So how I'm going to write that is that I'm going to say interval and then 3 day. Right. If I do this, you can clearly see that now this 18th of September has become 21st of September. So even a better way to represent this is that I can select now as well with this and I can show you this. So this is how it is. This is the current time and this is date add of 3 days. Now I can not only add 3 day, I can also add the, let's say, minutes, seconds, and so on, right? So how this function is useful is that if I'm going to normalize date and time, if I'm going to find the difference between date and time, or if I'm going to, let's say, organize date and time, and I'm going to compare it with some other date and time, this function will come handy. Okay, at later stage, wherever we are going to, do this, then we are going to use this. And obviously, as you may have already guessed, if you already have a date add function, if you have a date add function, you obviously you will have a date subtract function as well, which is date underscore sub. Right? So these kind of functions are really useful whenever you are playing with the data. It is not that you are going to morph the data or you are going to change the data. Maybe that can be the use case as well, specific to what we are trying to resolve. But usually these kind of functions are used to understand what kind of patterns are there within the date, or maybe to extract features out of date, or maybe to convert date into different time zones and all these things. So rather than changing the time zone of the current server itself, I can clearly, I don't want to go to a DB and I don't want to ask him, boss, you have to change the time zone. I can change, let's say, I can do a date add and I can change the representation of the date, okay, by, let's say, adding the time. So let's say this difference which I have is what, 15 is 5 hours, right? 5 hours 30 minutes. So I can do something like this as well. I think this will be hour. There must be some, yeah, okay. So it will be 5 hour, and then I can say no. I think at one go, I may not be able to do this. Maybe I'll have to check the documentation, but I can use hour and I can use, let's say, minutes, and I can figure out how I can exactly convert this. So maybe I can convert this to 4. No, this is date sub. I have to use date add. Date add, and let's say interval 4 hour, then it is 19. Okay, then let's say, let me just do 5 hour. Okay, so now it is 2023. This is a good thing. Now I can do another date add. I can do another date add. This is a quick way to do. So I'm going to say interval 30 minute. Let's see if this works. Exactly the current date and time in India. Right. So as you can see, what I'm trying to do is that I could understand what is the difference between the server time and my time zone. It's kind of 5 hours, 30 minutes behind. Right. So I've simply added it without making any change on the database. Right. So it's like I've converted the time zone. So I can clearly say this is as date in IST. Right. And this is date in IST. And this date might be, let's say, let's just assume this is date in UTC. Right. So date in UTC is this and date in IST is this. Right. So I can now easily play around with the time zones. Right, using simple functions, and this required no change on the database. I did not change any parameter. I did not do any shutdown. I don't have to go to any DB and so on. Right, so this is a very useful feature. Okay, so all of these kind of functions are already there in the MySQL documentation. I'm just taking randomly some of the functions that I have myself used, right, from time to do things. Okay, that does not mean that date add or date sub is the only function which is available in MySQL. You can understand it's a database which is like used in the enterprise level, right? So there can be many other functions as well, but I'm just going through a few of them. Okay, now one more quick thing, and then we can move ahead with the rest of the types of the functions. So this is a very important thing. This is where you will have to explore yourself. you will have to explore yourself a bit more. But I am just going to give you something to play around, and then you can play around with it, right? So let me just clear this and again select now. Okay, so I am selecting the current date. Now, obviously, as I said in the last session as well, so the format in which this date and time is YYYY hyphen MM hyphen, then this is DD space HH 24 hours, then this is colon, and then MI, which represents the minutes, then colon, and then it is double S, right? So this is the format which I can represent over it. It is YYYY, right? It is YYYY, and then the month, the date, right? Then the month, the date, and then the hour, right? Then I have the hour representation and the rest of the representations. Okay, I can also represent this in MySQL world. Okay, I can also represent this in the MySQL world with something like this: percentage Y, percentage M, percentage D, and then I put a space and say percentage T. Okay, now from where did I get this? I just remember this, that is why I'm giving you this example. But this entire list of such things that I can use is entirely available into the MySQL, let's say, documentation. Let's quickly try to use this over here using a function called date format, right? And maybe you can figure out the rest. You can look into the documentation and try to play around. Okay, please do give it a try if you have the environment. Just a side note, we are using AWS just to save space and software installation things and all those things on our Windows laptop. That does not mean that we cannot install MySQL on Windows. MySQL on Windows is actually far more interactive. The reason being, with MySQL on Windows, I can not only get this command line kind of an interface, I also get a IDE, Integrated Development Environment, which is known as MySQL Workbench. So Workbench is a additional software. If you go to MySQL website, right, you can download MySQL database for Windows first, install it. Then you can download MySQL Workbench for Windows, and then you can install it. And now, using the Workbench, which is an ID, you can connect to the MySQL database, which is running on your Windows machine, on your laptop, on your desktop. And then you should be able to fire these commands in a very interactive way inside an ID, which is like very organized and the screen is very good and all these things, right? But usually what happens is in a production or in an office environment, it is very seldom that you get a setup like this, because many few people will be using Windows operating systems on the production environments basis the experiences which we have seen. So many enterprise, let's say, data centers will still use Red Hat Linux or flavors of Unix. And that is the reason why we chose to go to AWS, create a VM, and then we did all these things, right? But on Windows also, this will work. So if you want to practice, you don't need to create an AWS account and you don't have to go in there mandatorily. If you already created, that is brilliant. That is really brilliant that they have done it. You have created an AWS account already. That was really not required. That was optional. We can also install these tools onto Windows and we can try around them, right? So just a side note. So please don't feel that I need to have an AWS account. Only then I can practice all these things. No. Okay. Now let's just quickly put this percentage Y, percentage M, and percentage D. Okay. If I put this and press enter, you see what is happening. My date time format, let me just clear the screen and do something over here. This is going to give me a good comparison. So now output is giving me a date as well as time. I just want the date out of it. So I extracted it also using date format. I've already seen another function by which we can do this, but this function is even more useful because now I can change the format. I can override the format. I can print this in any way I want. Okay, I can, let's say, print date and month and year. Right, I can do it in any way I want. I can use any delimiter here. Let's say usually we represent this by slash, right? So I can also use slash, right? So you see what is the flexibility here. So rather than believing or trusting or depending on any inbuilt function to format the date for you, you are calling the date format function itself, and then you are simply giving the format string, and then you are working on it. So this terminology that I use, right? This part, this is all known as the date time format string. Okay, I would strongly recommend that look at MySQL documentation and you try to find out what are the different flavors of date time format strings which are available into MySQL, and you can play around with them. right? There are many other where you can actually print day names, week names, year names, and Gregorian calendar, and all these things, right? So that's a very useful thing to do because it really helps from time to time, right? So let's just move ahead. I think what we have covered with respect to date time should be more than enough. I think we have covered some of the string functions. Date time functions are already covered. Let's look into some of the numeric functions. Okay. So in meanwhile, if you have any queries, please let me know.
No questions as of now.
Okay, then let's go ahead and then let's try to run some of let's say the numerical functions, and we'll understand what these numerical functions actually mean. Let me just see the tables, and let me just see what I can do with this table. So let's say select star from students. Okay, this is a good table, and why I say this is a good table is because there are numbers over here. Okay, so I'm going to use some functions on these numbers now, right? So what I'm going to do, let me select this. Select distinct GPA, okay, from students. So I get the distinct number of GPAs which all the students has got. Obviously, you have understood what is happening here. So what is happening here is there are 23 rows in the table, but since I've used the distinct clause, it is giving me the four distinct GPAs which the 23 students have got. Obviously, because I have, let's say, duplicates in the table, right? So now let's say I would like to do something like this. I see that this value is in fractions. I want the absolute value, and I can use functions like ABS. If I use functions like ABS, it is not giving me the real number. It is actually giving me the fraction in a very, very different way. So it depends on which version of MySQL you are using, how the absolute function is actually going to work. But absolute function gives you the absolute value of the number, right? It gives you the absolute value of the number. What if you would like to remove the decimal? So one way to remove the decimal will be, floor. If you use a floor function, okay, what it is doing is, it is taking the numbers, okay, it is taking each and every of these numbers and converting it to the nearest minimum number. Okay, what I mean by that is, if you have a number which is, let's say, 3.5, its floor will be 3, right? If you have a number which is 3.9, its floor will be 4. Its floor will be 3, not 4, right? It is closer to 4. I understand this is a bit of a confusing kind of function, but it's actually closer to floor 4, but it is taking, this floor function is taking the first value. Okay, and not the or the rounded value, right? 3.9, if I have to represent 3.74, let's say, in a rounded value, I may even say 3.74 is approximately equal to 4, right? But that's not what the floor function is doing. In a simple word, what floor function is doing, it is extracting the number before the decimal. So here, if I extract the number before the decimal, what do I get? 3, 3, 3 and 4, right? So 3 times 3 and 1 times 4. If I do a distinct, then I get two output, 3 and 4, right? Now I don't want that. This is actually rounding down the number to the closest lower integer. I don't want to do that. What if I want to round it to the closest higher integer? If I want to round it to the higher integer, then I will use a function called ceiling. If I use a function called ceiling, you see what it is doing. 3.5 is now converted to 4, 3.9 to 4, 3.74 to 4, and 4.8 is converted to 5. So you have 4, 4, 4, and 5. So 4 and 5 is the distinct of. Right? Now, even I want to be even more specific, and I don't want to do this. I really don't want to do this because this floor and ceiling is actually, or maybe in some cases, it's going to confuse me. Why don't I simply use a function called round? If I use a function called round, let's see what it is exactly doing. I'll select GPA and the round of GPA. So 3.5 gets converted to 4. Why? Because this GPA has a decimal place of 0.5. Had it been 3.4, it would have rounded it to 3. I have 3.5, that's why it rounded it to 4. If I had 3.3, it would have rounded it to 3. So 3.5 gets converted to 4, 3.9 also 4, 3.74 is 4, 4.8 is 5. Right? Now this, obviously, this output is the same, this round output, okay? Let me just compare the round output. Let me just compare the round output with the ceiling output. If I compare this, well, there is no difference. And what is the advantage of using round? The advantage of using round comes, if I'm going to pass another optional parameter after comma, and that is to how many decimals I would like to round it. So let's say 2. If I now round it to 2 places of the decimals, then it makes sense. Why am I going to use round? If I'm going to use round, this is what is going to happen. Even more interesting example will be if I round this to 1. Now let's see what it is going to do with this number. I hope you have already guessed. GPA rounded to 1 value is 3.7. And not 3.8. Had it been the case, this was 3.79, it would have rounded it to 3.8. Right? This is simple math. Right? This is simple math. Only the name of the functions are actually a bit, let's say, difficult or a bit, let's say, changing when it comes to MySQL scenario. So joining all the dots, I can say I can use this floor function. Sorry, there was a spelling mistake. Let me just, let's say, correct it. So this is what the difference, you can clearly see what is the difference between floor function, ceiling function, and the round function. Right? You can use any number of, let's say, decimals in the round function. Let me clear the screen and I can say fly places decimal as well. Right? So this is exactly what is the use of this very, very basic numeric functions. Right? We have already seen numeric functions like AVG. Or average. Okay, let me remind you, that's not a numeric function, although it is doing a numeric operation. This is where sometimes we might get confused, but please don't. There can be functions like average, sum, like these are giving you an output which is a numeric output. Yeah, of course, if I take an average, obviously it is actually giving me a numeric output, I understand. But average is not a calculation, it is a grouping. Why it is not a calculation and it is a grouping is because calculation in any database or any mathematical equation applies to each and every form or each and every tuple or each and every row. In this case, that's exactly what is happening when I'm using floor or ceiling or round. You see, for each and every row, for each and every value of GPA, I'm applying the floor function or the ceiling function or the round GPA comma 5 function. But if I use an average function, it works on the overall table, right? It is going to work on the overall table even if the output is a numeric value. So that's why the average function or sum function is actually an aggregate function and not a numeric function, even if the output is that of a number, right? Even if the output is that of a number. Right? So let's not get confused with them. Okay? Let's just move ahead and see some other cases as well. Okay? Some other cases will be, let's say, I can have some other functions like, there is one very cool function. Let me just show you that. So I just remember that. So let's take a value minus 183.34456, comma 3. Okay, if I do this, okay. Oh, yes, of course, yes, I did a mistake. This should be dot, right? I wanted a decimal and I entered a comma. So now see what it is doing. It is rounding the function. I may want to, let's say, not round the function. But can I do this in some other way? Okay, let me see if I can do this in some other way. In MySQL, there is also another way, which is called truncate. Now, if I do a truncate and if I do a round, what is the difference? The difference is round is doing the mathematical meaning of round. It is rounding up the numbers. Why did it represent this as 0.245 is because in the actual value I have 0.24456. So because point after 4 I have 5, which is greater than 4, that's why it rounded last value of 4 as 5. But in case of truncate, it is like trimming. It is like that substring function which you have used in string, right? It is simply a substring function. That's all. Truncate works as a substring function in case of numeric values. Okay, can I not use a substring function over here? Can I not use a substring function? Let's see, substr. The point is, yes, I can use. I can treat that as a substring function. Right? I can treat this as a substring function as well. I can use substring function on a numbers as well. But substring function is going to work as per what it is supposed to work. Right? It's not going to truncate always because it is going to work in its own way, and truncate is going to work in its own way. Right? So that's the difference here. So that's another useful function that we can use. Now let's look into some additional functions. These are some additional numeric functions which you may want to use from time to time. This may really be required, although not always, but if you would like to, let's say, create or let's say generate, it's a mathematical values, then this can be useful. Floor ceiling can be called window function. I don't think it can be because it's not really windowing. It is not, let's say, window functions are usually where you have the actual operation, which is an aggregation, right? But in this case, you're not aggregating anything. Right, in case of window functions, if you remember, when we used window functions, all the examples we have seen, or the examples you can see on the internet, is where you are using an aggregation function. So window function has an over clause inside which you may want to use an aggregation function, right? But these are not the aggregates. Right, let's say continue. I'd just like to show you some more function. Let me clear this. So now I'm going to select the value of pi. These are the unique or let's say different kind of numerical functions which are available, just like now. Okay, now bracket was giving you the current date and time. Pi bracket is giving you the current value of pi or the actual value of pi. Okay, there are other functions like, let's say, degrees. Okay, if I select degrees, it is not going to print anything. I have to enter something over there in the parameters and it is going to return me the degrees. Okay, then I have similar other functions like, let's say, radians. Okay, I can calculate the mathematical radian out of it. Okay, I have other functions like sine, cos, tan. Right, I can pass the values of the degrees and I should be able to find out the sine. So let's say I can try something, sine of, let's say, 180. Okay, sine of 180 is minus 0.8. So that's the degree that I have passed, and I am taking a sine theta. Right, so theta in this case is 180. If I take a sine of that, it is minus 8. If I change this 80 to 90, it is going to come plus 0.9. Right, so these kind of functions are also available. If at any point in time we would like to use them, we can use them. But there is one function which we may want to use very frequently or in many of the cases, and that is the square root. So let's say I would like to find the square root of 4 and it gives me the answer as 2. Why is this essential? This might be essential in case we would like to, inside the database only, perform the mathematical calculations rather than doing it in a pandas data frame or rather than doing it in a Jupyter notebook and so on. Right, so this kind of functions are also available. It is already explained in the database, let's say, manual, and we can look into it whenever or wherever we have such kind of, let's say, use cases where we would have to use such kind of functions. We can make use of it. Okay, let's move on. The next thing are the aggregation functions. Now, aggregate functions we have already seen, but let me just try to quickly elaborate what are the various types of aggregate functions. We have already seen some aggregate functions like sum and average and all these things, right? But there are certain types of aggregate functions as well. So let's try to define what are the three major classes of aggregate functions which we can have. One type of aggregate functions, okay? There is one type of aggregate functions which is going to do the counting, okay? There are one kind of aggregate functions which is always used to count the values. We have already seen one, count star. Count star is actually an aggregate function. If I have 23 rows in my students table, I do a select count star from students, I get an output 23. That's one type of count function. The other type of aggregate function, the other type of aggregate function is the averaging function, right? So the other type is averaging. So I can do the averaging of the numbers. So the AVG function that we have seen is actually doing the same thing, right? And then I can also have a third kind, which is finding min or finding max. Now, these three categories that I am showing you, these can actually be linked to specific functions. Example, when count is done using count function, okay? Average is done using AVG function. Okay, and mean max is done using, there is a mean function, there is a max function. Now, why are we then differentiating the aggregate functions basis the actual functions and not the type of the function? It is a type as well as the aggregate function, right? It is a type as well as the actual function. But why I explained these three to you specifically is because these are the most commonly used that you will ever use during your life cycle in the database. Will you either count or take an average, otherwise known as the mathematical mean. Okay, this is the same as taking a mean. Okay, this is the algebraic mean. Okay, either you are going to take an algebraic mean, or you are going to take a count of the records, or you're going to take a mean and max of the records. This will really come helpful when we have a lot of tables. Let's say we have one table for my customers, one table for all the sales that the customer has done. Okay, one table for all the discounts that the customer has got, and one table for all the promo codes that the customer has used and so on. So let's say I want to create a data set containing the features, containing the properties of all the customers. So what I'm going to write, customer ID 1 has done sales. Okay, number of sales. Let's say this is a column. Number of sales the customer ID has done is 30. Okay, number of times he has opted for a discount is, let's say, 15. And number of unique promo codes the customer has used is 3. So using 3 specific promo codes, he has taken 15 times discount out of 30 total transactions that he has done. This creates a row for my final output, which I may want to use to, let's say, cluster my customers to find, let's say, patterns in how customers are taking discounts and using promo codes and so on. Now you might be wondering, how am I going to do it? Obviously, these three tables are going to have the customer ID as the common key. So I'm going to join three tables and find out this information. Right? I can use multiple types of joining and aggregating techniques, and I should be able to do this. And that is the practical use of using the aggregate functions when you are finally going to create a data set about the properties of a customer. Like how many times the customer logged on onto the website, out of which how many times he got an error, how many times he got a success message, how many times he used a promo code, how many times he used a credit card to make a payment, how many times he has used a cash payment method, and so on. This creates a very good data set about the properties of a customer, and then you can maybe cluster the customers into 3 or 4, let's say, categories, and then you can create specific marketing plans for those, let's say, customers. Right, so that's the practical use of these three kind of functions which we have. Right, so let's look into some of the functions and we will be able to understand what we are doing, although we have already looked earlier, but let's just quickly revise. Okay, So the very basic function count start from courses. Four, right? This is an aggregation function which is giving me counting, right? Another example will be, this is a bad example. Let me just take min of GPA, max of GPA, and the average of GPA from students. Just a moment, give me 1 minute. I'm actually getting a call. Right, so what I have been doing over here is I am taking a minimum, I am taking a maximum, and I am taking an average. Right, so these three I have combined. So this is like the averaging function, this is the min, and this is the max function. Give me 1 minute over here. Yeah, sorry for that. So here, as you can see, I've used a combination of min, max, and average, right? So this is the usage of that, right? So that's how you can really use this kind of functions, okay? And then you can also combine these functions as well. Let's say select star from students. I'm selecting all the columns having where GPA, okay, the student's GPA. I would like to know all the students who have a GPA greater than the average of GPA. So I do an inline query, select average GPA from students, right? Or maybe even better, I can do, because I have, let's say, multiple rows over here, right? So maybe I'm going to do distinct name. And I'm going to get the name of that specific, let's say, student who have got a GPA which is greater than the average GPA. Right? Obviously, everyone will be greater than minimum and everyone will be less than maximum. Right? I can even do this where I would just like to know who has got the highest. Right, the highest GPA is again that one student which I, you know, duplicated the data. So that's one student who has got the highest GPA. Right, so these are some of the ways in which you can mix and match regular queries with the aggregated queries using techniques like inline queries and so on. Right, so in this case, as you can see, we have mixed three to four kind of concepts. We are using keywords like distinct, we are doing a where clause. We are then finding the value from a subquery or an inline query. Inside the inline query, we are using aggregate functions and so on, right? So this is the kind of way you will actually combine one or more techniques, and by means of that, you are going to figure out things, right? I hope until this point in time, it was clear, and I hope I was able to make you understand what is the actual essence of using an aggregate function, right? So this is exactly what kind of cases we use them. Now, aggregate functions are usually, if you are going to run them inline, we have already seen this, we are going to use group by clause and we are going to use having clause, right? But let's just look into one such variation, just one kind of a variation. Just one variation I just wanted to cover. So let's say again, I'm going to select star from students, okay? Again, I'm going to select, let's say, star from students, or maybe, if and better, name and average of GPA. Okay, name and average of GPA from students. Okay, right? Group by name. Right, so this is a very simple query. It gives me the output. I can also do this kind of thing. Okay, I can also do, let's say I'm going to round this value to zero places of, it's a decimal, and I can give a very good kind of an output. Let's say I'm not going to do it zero, I'm going to do it two places. Right, now one thing I wanted to quickly show you is this. I can use a having function, I can use a having clause, and then I can say that wherever the average GPA, okay, is greater than or equal to 4, or the average GPA is greater than or equal to 3. Right, so these are the students, or maybe the average GPA, maybe even a better example will be 3.5. Right, but you have to remember that here I took 3.5, it gives me everything, right? So why not greater than? Yeah, so it has successfully converted 3.5 to two places. So it is not that I am using a round here, so it has two places, and here I'm not using round, it has a single place, it will not work. No, that's not the case. This is purely a mathematical function and it works. Right? So it has out of the box worked like this. Right? I hope there are no questions until this point in time. So this was just a small example of how we can use the having function. Okay, now there is one thing which I wanted to show you. One thing which I wanted to show you is kind of a keyword. It's not a function, it's a keyword. And I'm going to just use, let's say, two aggregate functions. Or let's say, I can use one also. That is not an issue. Name, let's say name, and let's say average, or let's say I'm going to use this one only. Okay. So this is the query that I'm going to use. And then at the end, now I'm going to add a new keyword. Okay. With roll up. Right. So what it is doing is it is actually adding. It is actually adding another row at the end. It is giving it a name of null. Not sure why. It is giving it a name of null, and it is printing a value 4.6. Right? Now, what is this 4.6? Let's just try and understand what is this one. Select average, okay, or maybe even better, round average of GPA, comma, 2 from students. This is the overall average of GPA for all my students. And what it has done is it has printed this tabular output of student and the aggregation, name and the aggregation, the name and the aggregation, name and the aggregation. And then the last row, it is actually producing me the overall average. It does not look good, right? It does not look good. So can I change this? Can I change this null to something, let's say, known as, let's say, total? If I print total over here, it's going to be very beautiful, right? So this is where I'm going to show you a trick. This is where I'm going to show you a statement, which is very, very commonly used in the database world. It is also known as a case statement. A case statement is used something like this. Case when name, the value of name is equal to null, then I print the word total, else name, end. Right? If I do this, it has not taken it into effect because null is actually a keyword. So why don't I try with this? Is null. Yeah. Right? So when, okay, this portion is actually the most important thing. So what we are doing over here is, let me just explain this to you, and let me just paste it over here and then I can explain. So what this portion is doing is, it is saying, take a case by case basis, start from here, end from here. A case always begins with case, ends with end. It can optionally end with an alias. So you can also say end as something, you can give it a name. right? Because it has printed the entire function over here. So you can give it a very useful name over here. So case is having this code inside it. So what it is executing is this. So when the value of this column is null, then you print the word total instead of null, else you print the name. Right? So this is what the case statement is doing. It is checking for a condition, case, when something or some condition matches, then do this. When some other condition matches, then do this until you call an end. So it is going to execute all of these pairs of statements. So this is a pair, this is a pair, and so on. So pairwise, it is going to execute this condition one, then output one. Condition two, then output two. Okay, this is a pair P1, this is a pair P2. You can have innumerous number of pairs, infinite pairs. Infinite pairs. I can say case when name is equal to Anna, print X. Case when name equal to Mugdha, print Y. Name equal to Rohi, print Z. And name equal to Sarangs, print ABC. Name equal to Sudhasatva, name or print null, and so on. Right? And then I can end. In this specific use case, I just wanted to replace this null with the text total. So that's what I've done. Case where name is null, this is my condition. Then, rather than the name, you print this value. Else, if the name is not null, you print name. It's just like an if-else condition which you have seen in Python programming. Right? So these are kind of tips and tricks that you can use with respect to what we can do while, let's say, running the query. I believe we have covered quite much ground. This gives a quite good effect. This gives a very good, a good overview of what we can do, right? So I think this should be, I think it's kind of a logical stop because we don't have much more advanced functions to look into. I mean, these kind of functions are also, I mean, these are more than enough for us to continue. With the databases, I believe we have looked into much now. So I would strongly recommend, Rohi, that you can install this into your, let's say, any VM, or you can install this into Windows and try out things, right? You can install this onto AWS, wherever you want, and you have to give it a try. You have to practice a few things. So what I'm planning to do is that in our group, I'm going to share exercises. I'm going to share, let's say, daily practices that we can do. If you find some time, you can go through the practices and you can do them, right? So let's make a logical close over here. And then maybe from next week, we can continue with some other database and the next, let's say, topics. Yeah?
Okay, sure.
Okay.
Also, one small thing. Do we have to write case in the beginning also? We can write anywhere, even at the end.
No, you can write case anywhere because it is just a statement. So you can use case.
Okay.
No, you can use case anywhere. So you can use that case at any point in time. It is just another column. So you are simply formulating a column using the case statement.
Okay, sure. But thanks.
Okay. Okay, then. And we are going to continue from Monday. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Good night.